We are going to talk about this painting soon, but I thought I'd start out by asking Jim about his own career and how he came to conservation of paintings, and what kind of training you had, and how you ended up at MoMA, etc.
I'll try to make that as brief a story as possible. I guess I would say that I wound up in conservation because I had a very good liberal arts education. I went to college determined to be a biology major. I followed through on that, but by the time I was finishing, I was much more interested and capable in art history. And I happened to have professors who knew about the world of conservation, and they helped direct me towards conservation, which is, as I think you probably intuit or know, is something of a mix of at least some scientific training, some art training, and some art historical training. All of these fit into how one thinks about and how one does conservation. That led to graduate school in conservation, and I got a graduate degree in paintings conservation. I'm a paintings conservator. Trained.
Where did you go to school?
The University of Delaware. They have a program jointly with the Winterthur program. There are two other conservation, at least fine arts conservation programs in the country. One is at NYU, and the other is at in Buffalo, at State University of Buffalo. So then, how did I get to MoMA? After graduating from conservation school, I worked for a while with a private conservator in Washington, then was at the Met on a fellowship for almost 4 years, and from there to MoMA.
And how long were you at MoMA altogether?
30 years.
Okay. So how does MoMA, and how did you as chief conservator there, are we getting a little bit of feedback, I think?
Nope.
You know what?
We'll figure it out.
I think it's that speaker.
Yes. Okay.
How does MoMA choose a painting for restoration among the many works that they have in the museum? And why did they choose the Demoiselles in, I don't know when it was, 2002, 2003 in there for?
Yeah, it's actually a little longer story than that even. But to your first question, generally, how are works chosen? There are multiple routes that it might happen, but MoMA, and I think that this is fairly typical of most institutions these days, MoMA is an exhibition-driven institution, as are most museums, certainly major museums. And as works go in and out on loan for exhibitions, they are checked by conservators. So we're able to keep up on the collection, or at least much of the collection that is traveling around either in MoMA exhibitions or as loans to other institutions, and can sort of note questions and problems in that process. So that's how some come to the surface. In the case of the Demoiselles, when MoMA did a Matisse retrospective in 1992, there was a brief period after that exhibition. It was a major exhibition that John Elderfield did. John was able to keep a couple of major other paintings by Matisse there, in particular Bathers by the River, which is the Art Institute of Chicago. And it's often thought that Bathers by the River was at least part, if not Matisse's greatest response to the Demoiselles. It's an ambitious painting. It is also very large scale. And he hung the two in the same room together so that he, scholars, and the public could take a look at these and make that side-by-side comparison that perhaps Matisse was making in his own mind. And what we saw there was that the Demoiselles, as was argued in this film and many other places, the Demoiselles did not carry the day. It didn't seem to have quite the punch that would have prompted somebody to be as ambitious as Matisse was to paint Bathers by the River, and all of the responses that the literature suggested other artists had. And the fact that it didn't sort of wow us that way, we didn't think was Picasso's fault. We thought that it was probably the condition of the painting, and that, so that would have been 1992 that we began to say, you know, this picture really is not all it might be, and we should investigate why it's not as strong a picture as it seems or should be. Why did it take us another 10 years to get around to it? Well, because it's the Demoiselles d'Avignon. It's a painting, one of the few works of art that people will come from around the world to see. And it's something that you do not want to have off you without very, very good reason. As Anne said, she thinks that it's probably been on the walls of the museum ever since the museum bought it. That's not quite accurate, but it's just about exactly right. So we had to choose our moment, and that moment was during an expansion. The museum closed on 53rd Street in 2000 and reopened in 2004. So after the Matisse-Picasso exhibition that the museum held in temporary quarters out in Queens, we took the Demoiselle for, I think it was about 8 months, or maybe a bit more, and we had targeted that time a few years in advance. As the time that we would do the restoration. And we could do all the research necessary leading up to that time so that we could make it as quick a restoration as possible.
And when you say you were doing the research, do you have to know about the historical context? What is it that you need to know before you even begin work on a painting?
Well, you would like to know as much as you can, certainly about the historical context. You'd like to know as much about the materials and how those materials might be aging and changing over time. Well, with a work like the Demoiselle, you're going to expend all the resources available to you. And so we did a fair amount of technical scientific analysis to understand the paints and the pigments. As it happens, it's a very straightforwardly created painting, and that is the way Picasso painted throughout his life in a pretty straightforward manner. His works on paper or the collages and the sculptures, they're quite a different story. He was far more experimental in his techniques and materials there. So that was not really revelatory, any of that research. We also did technical imaging, as we call it, taking x-rays in order to see what the changes might be in the painting, changes in the composition. And I think that it's fairly evident that if you look at this painting closely, you'll see a lot of heavy paint and reworking of paint in the faces of the two figures on the right side. The rest of the picture is painted fairly quickly and directly, but those two have multiple layers of paint, and you can see that. And so just by looking at it with the naked eye. So we x-radiographed the whole painting, but those two revealed a number of sort of shifts of the composition of those heads. But again, that didn't really have any impact on what we did in the way of the conservation of the painting. That was just more historical, art historical information of interest.
So tell us about what happened when you started to actually look at the canvas and yeah. examine it, and yeah. were there surprises? And
oh, no surprises. That's very important. And I should say that I was involved with this restoration, but not very much in the hands-on restoration. That was done by my colleague Michael Duffy at MoMA. But what we did find over the course of this, what we knew going in from our testing and just sort of looking at it, it had a layer of surface dirt on it that it accumulated over many decades. There was a varnish layer on it, which had also discolored somewhat. It had gone a little bit yellowish over time. And those were the principal reasons why it didn't sort of pack a punch the way we thought. There was just this generally muting quality to the dirt and grime and the discolored varnish. But we could also see, both from the record and from our own examinations, that there had been prior restorations on this work. And those needed to be corrected and rectified because they had gone out of balance with the work as well.
Were those restorations that happened while the painting was in the MoMA collection?
Some, yes. So the painting was in Picasso's possession for 17 or more years, painted in 1907, and Jacques Doucet bought it, I think, in 24. He moved studios 8 times, I believe, during that period. So it traveled around Paris with him. And in each case, he would have needed to roll it up and get it out the door that way. And this would have distressed the paint surface to some extent. And there's actually a funny anecdote, and it's interesting how works like this can create sort of myths around them. Leo Stein, Gertrude Stein's brother, wrote that Picasso knew that this was going to be a masterpiece before he even started it. And he was so confident of that that he had the painting lined before he even started it. So what do I mean by lining? That's essentially the attaching of a second canvas to the original canvas. It rigidifies the original canvas, gives it a little more strength, and prevents, the idea is that it should minimize movement on the surface of the canvas, and prevent paint from popping off. Over the centuries, many works by Velázquez and other great artists who Picasso admired would have had their pictures lined, and apparently he knew this. So he's just going to beat him to the punch and line his masterpiece before he painted it. But the fact of the matter is that can't possibly be true, because the physical evidence on the painting is tells us that, in fact, this painting was rolled, and you would not be able to roll a lined painting. It would be far too stiff for that. So, and what is the evidence that we have that it was, in fact, rolled? There are a whole series of very evenly spaced vertical losses through the canvas. They're spaced about, this far apart each. So that would probably be about half the diameter of the tube that he rolled this painting around as he moved from studio to studio. And in the course of that rolling, the paint at some point or at multiple times while being rolled and unrolled popped off along these lines here. And so there were restorations that were done probably when it was first acquired by Jacques Doucet in 24 that would have filled those losses to make the overall picture continuous, so that your eye wouldn't be stopped by these vertical lines all the way throughout the painting. They would have just filled them in to match the paint on either side. Those restorations, so it's mostly that restoration that we were, and some subsequent restorations to those same areas, a few small losses in the painting that we removed and then refilled to bring them back to the level of the surface of the original paint, and then again match those losses to the paint on either side.
And how has the art of restoration changed over the course of the years that the Demoiselle was, from when it was painted up until the restoration of 2004?
I think that if you're, a general rule would be we tend to be less interventive. It's hard for me, the painting was probably lined. The lining that it does have now, as I say, was not applied by Picasso. It was probably applied when it went to Jacques Doucet's collection, and that would be a mere 17 years after the picture was painted. That is as extreme a structural treatment as one can do to a painting. And I think that we would be very loath to do that to a 17-year-old painting for any number of reasons now, not the least of which is that certainly working in museums, but I think even private collectors, would just prefer to sort of wait it out and see, do I really need to be that aggressive in my treatment? Perhaps I can just sort of watch and restore it, small little losses that might come up rather than just sort of take it all out in one go.
And when you say restore the losses, how are you what are you using to restore?
Yeah, and I think this touches on and gets to another very important change in the sort of professionalization of conservation in the decades since the Demoiselle was painted, and really since the Second World War. And that is the principle of reversibility. What one does to a painting, whatever materials one adds, should be easily reversible without affecting any of the original material. So when we take the case of a loss, original paint is lost in the oil paint film, say in Picasso, let's say it's about this large. One would fill that with a material that is reversible, probably some sort of a plastic material, but it might even just be a simple ground gesso-like material. And then one would retouch with, again, reversible paints on top. It could be watercolor, it could be some sort of synthetic medium, but the idea being that if somebody needs to come take that off, let's say it discolors and no longer matches well in a few decades, or let's say just the theory of conservation changes and one wants to show the archaeological state of the demoiselle. One can do that without affecting the original. All of that stuff that we put on in the early 2000s would come off readily without affecting the original paint.
And do you use varnishes these days?
Varnishes is very contextual to the particular work, to the artists and the artist's desires for their work. In the case of the demoiselle, the varnish that we took off, we put no varnish back on. There was no evidence either in the record or of what anybody wrote. And certainly the varnish that we took off was a synthetic varnish that was, which would not have been available to Picasso at the time. So all of the evidence was that this picture was not varnished originally, and far be it from us to varnish it. Well, why not? Is there a protective function of varnish? Possibly, but it will overall creates a unifying gloss and surface to the painting that certainly somebody with the acute eye of Picasso would have been alert to, and he clearly chose not to do that.
Let's take some questions from the audience. Somebody? There we are.
So I'm just curious, when a painting is rolled, and you said with Picasso this painting must have been rolled multiple times, wouldn't he have noticed the losses that were created with the rolling process? And do artists ever try to conserve their own paintings?
To that last question, yes. But as often as not, certainly talking to the artists that I've come to know over the years, they're not, you know, they're on to the next thing. They're not that interested in revisiting what they've done. I can't answer the first question. Why would Picasso not have restored these losses? And the only answer I can give would be that he was no different from the artists of today. He was interested in something else by then.
How are you? I'm curious about, because as you said, he did not choose to use a varnish on the painting. He was very, in the paintings, he's very simple in his approach, right, his process. What did he use a medium for the oil painting? Did he use just turpentine? Did he mix in anything with his paint as a medium that you know of?
I think in the Demoiselle, it was pretty much straight out of the tube. He might have thinned a few colors, you know, but that he used turpentine in his studio is plenty evident. Some of the pictures you saw there were very thinly painted, and even there's evidence that he had sort of gotten some a lot of turpentine, and you'll see drips. The turpentine was solubilizing the paint and dripping down in some of those pictures. In the case of the Demoiselle, it is really very straightforwardly painted. There's not a lot of, if any, messing around with the medium.
We've got another question back here.
Okay.
This is a question about discussion in the art world of copies. By analogy with like classical music, you know, Beethoven or Bach wrote a piece, but the tradition there is that musicians perform it. They try to be loyal to what was written, but it's tolerated if they add a little bit of their own perspective. But in painting, I mean, I remember hearing about a couple of painting forgers who were incredibly talented, and I'm sure there could be technology that would kind of scan this picture and then have some robot repaint something. So I'm not asking about this particular picture, but in general, are people thinking about that it was the idea that Picasso or any artist wanted to represent that's important, not only the first physical instantiation?
I think that there is a fundamental difference in the initial conception between performed art and fine art, created art. And even as revolutionary as Picasso was, the touch, the hand of the artist, I think Picasso would really think nobody else could do this. I think that's kind of the point that Anne Umland was, and all of the other curators were making here. This is unique. This sprung not just from Picasso's brain, but from his hand, from his talent. So whereas Bach, you know, he knew somebody else would perform it. It was always part of that conception. So as far as fakes go, you know, yeah, there are fakes out there, and the really good ones we don't know are fakes.
And I would just mention Andy Warhol as well, who had just a completely different approach where copying and mass reproduction of things becomes part of his art.
Yeah. Yes, and then you have, I mean, what we're running up against here is that we live in an era that is informed by Andy Warhol, informed by pop art, informed by people incorporating the mass-produced nature, the commodification nature of our world into the art world and querying that. And then you have conceptual art where it's just, as you say, the idea. And you know, we tend to think, well, now art is just a set of instructions. Everything is far more complicated than I've reduced it to there, but we can't apply that kind of thinking to 1907. In 1907, we had only what we had prior to 1907. We don't have the 60s. To plant into Picasso's skull and have, oh, well, that's what he was thinking about.
We've got another question back here.
Okay.
There's a story that in 1918, a exhibition of Picasso's work and Matisse's work together was organized. And Demoiselles was part of that exhibition. And when the painting arrived at the gallery, to get hung onto the wall, they couldn't get it through the door. And a crowd gathered, and this became a great story. Well, now, since you've told us that Picasso was used to rolling it up, I wonder if there wasn't a bit of a good marketer there as well as a good painter. Did he do that on purpose?
Possibly. You know, that's the first time I have actually heard that story, so it would be interesting to go back and see, you know, the location of the gallery, what one could reconstruct around the plausibility of it, or if that is, you know, as I say, myth can accumulate around these works. I would, though, in terms of size of picture and ambition of picture, I think one of the most interesting things about the Demoiselles and is that it's really almost perfectly square. Now, traditionally, you have landscape format and portrait format. That's what you learn in art school, and portraits are vertical, landscapes are horizontal. This is really neither. And just the nature of the subject matter is going to be discombobulated by that square format.
It's not really a question. What astonished me on this one that the that Moselle showing the sketches of his studies, and then Guernica, that I only found out a few years ago, that it took a year for him to really compose that. So when we talk about performance, I mean, he really knew how long to study something and to present it, that which is, in many artists, the most difficult part to stop.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, you know, Alexander Calder was asked, well, how do you know when you're done? And he said, when it's dinner time. But in regards to the Demoiselles, there are copious studies, both individual heads and formed and bodies and nudes and overall compositions. He really was thinking about this and trying to construct this in his mind. And one of the ways we know that he approached this canvas with a lot of confidence that this is the composition that he was going to do is that he actually, on the far right side there, it looks sort of whitish, grayish. That's the ground. He is, you know, he's not painted that in. He has just sort of put everything in around it. He knew where everything pretty much was going to go by the time he started on the canvas.
Since you brought up Guernica, I was curious, and you were talking about how exhibitions often drive what is going to be restored. I can't remember when Guernica was moved out.
Before my time.
Oh, okay, it was that long ago. No, 30 years. I'm just saying the 30 years.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Within my memory, I thought it was more like 20 years ago.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
In any case, that's okay. So it had the restoration of Demoiselles had nothing to do with
no.
Guernica at all.
No.
Okay.
We've got another question right.
Yes.
I'd like to know, how did the conservation affect the way that you see the painting? How did it change your perception?
Thank you. You know, I think that it is that the restoration itself was not terribly dramatic. What we took off in the way of grime and dirt and discolored varnish, you know, it was not like the cleaning of an old master where, you know, the chocolate brown sky suddenly becomes blue. It wasn't this, that kind of dramatic change. And yet, it seems to have made a huge difference in the subtleties. And I think that being able to read the subtleties in this makes you realize that that is what differentiates a truly great painting from a really good painting. What do I mean by that? First of all, the varnish, even though it was a thin varnish, a varnish begins to fill the texture of the brushstroke. And by releasing that, a little bit more of Picasso's hand and touch became readily evident to us. And then just the subtle transitions across some of the forms. Even though this is very plainer in the way he treats the forms, there is still a little bit more there that he's playing with that maybe, you know, he was just sort of working with for himself, but that the confidence of the brushstroke and so on just became all that much more evident. And how can that be with Picasso? Because he's the most confident painter in the world, it seems. Yeah.
Let's take one last question.
Hello. Okay, sorry. Hello. First of all, thank you so much for sharing your vast knowledge with us.
Thank
it
you.
It was really, really fascinating. And I just want to, I don't actually have a question, I just wanted to share something with you, and that is the MoMA exhibit on Jackson Pollock was eye-opening for me. Before that, I always thought anybody could scribble. But watching that exhibit together with the jazz music that was available was really phenomenal and made me start to really like to Pollock a lot. The Gerhard Richter exhibit at MoMA again, was vastly contributed to my love of the film Never Look Away just a few months ago here. And this, oh yes, and the MoMA exhibit at the at Queens with Picasso and Matisse was one of the most fun and memorable exhibits that I've ever seen. And I think this film here tonight might actually finally make me like and appreciate Picasso's cubism phase, which just never ever really appealed to me so much, but I think it just might. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you. And, you know, I would just actually turn to my former colleague and friend Ann Umlin there, and it sounds to me like you've been intuitively taking her advice and stopping and looking for longer at these artists and as a result of these exhibitions. Go back to MoMA and take a look at those Cubist pictures, and just reconstruct. You've got a little bit of coaching because they have titles, so the subject matter is there in the title potentially. Think about how he has deconstructed that space and reconstructed it. And let me leave you with one other thought from the great art historian Leo Steinberg, because I think hanging in that same gallery is a woman plaiting her hair, combing her hair. And he once said, as we were looking at the Demoiselle, and that was hanging right next to it at the time, he said, you know, I asked my students to say, how old is that woman in that picture? And, you know, well, 20, 30, you know. And the right answer for Leo Steinberg, and the right answer is, thousands of years old, because that's where Picasso is thinking, and that is the tradition that he's in, and that is the tradition that he's trying to have a dialogue with. So, you know, just let your mind run to 1,000 years ago, not just the 2 or 3 years of around 1907.
Thank you so much, Jim.